हेलो मैडम, माय स्लाइड इज विजिबल। हेलो हेलो,
इट्स विजिबल।
इट्स विजिबल
यस यस
एंड आई एम ऑडिबल आल्सो। ओके
यस क्वाइट ऑडिबल। कंटिन्यू
ओके,
विद योर टॉक।
रिस्पेक्टेड चेयरपर्सन मैडम एंड द ऑगस्ट गैदरिंग, आई एम रियली good evening everybody. I am really thankful at the outset. I express my gratefulness to Dr. Chad Panda, Dr. Arunuj Maheshwari and Dr. Muruganathan for giving me a very important topic like sepsis associated acute kidney injury. Actually, whatever importance we do pay to this topic, that is sepsis associated AKI, that is SA-AKI, really it deserve more. And through my discussion, I think it will be clear to the August gathering that we have to pay in our days in and days out clinical practice, bedside clinical practice, we have to pay required amount of importance to this topic. Otherwise, we may miss and we may increase mortality when our patient presents with this. Not moving. Just a minute, it's not moving. Some technical glitch is there. So I should touch upon briefly the following points to cover this in my next 15 to 20 minutes to cover the topic. That is, I will touch upon introductions, then what is sepsis and AKI, acute kidney injury, role of biomarkers in AKI, outcome of sepsis associated AKI management, and conclusion. So, sepsis associated acute kidney injury, sepsis may affect in many organs, we do know, but kidney is the most important organ to be affected in sepsis. And AKI complicates 50% of severe sepsis. And regardless of the cause and associated comorbidities, all AKI remains a diagnosis based on increases in serum creatinine, as well as decrease in urine output. Till today, decades old serum creatinine level and urine output level, that depending on these two factors, we are trying to diagnose AKI, but we have to bank upon some others that will be discussed later in my later slide. So what is sepsis? Sepsis is nothing but defined as organ dysfunction resulting from host dysregulated response, and that is deleterious to the host. So dysregulated response of infections to host infections is sepsis. So how do we find out clinically that the response is dysregulated? And that response is dysregulated, we can find out by the presence of, we all know that is by the presence of SARS. And SARS is diagnosed by four important factors, PRT and total WBC count. PRT means pulse, respiration temperature, and WBC count below 4,000 or above 12,000. So we all know I am discussing that. So if there is presence of SARS, any two of these four criteria, we will call it that infection has converted into sepsis. And severe sepsis is always there, we consider when there is organ dysfunction. And septic shock, when we call it is a septic shock, when fluid unresponsive hypotension is being found along with sepsis. So this is the definitions of sepsis. There is another criteria for bedside clinical diagnosis of sepsis is qSOFA. And that has been told by sepsis 3, that is the global diagnosis, global definitions of sepsis, third international conference. They have said that SOFA, the more quickly, that is qSOFA, that is sequential organ failure assessment, that quick 3 points can give you a clue that patient is having sepsis, not only infection. These three, out of these three criteria, if two is present, one is blood pressure below 100, systolic BP, tachypnea more than 22, and altered sensorium. If two of these three present, we call that it is not a simple infection, but sepsis is there. And meta-analysis shows that if I go by SARS, so far sepsis criteria is concerned, then it is it shows better sensitivity. If I go by Q so far, it is better mortality predictability. And Q so far, if it is positive, it shows the 10% mortality in all in-hospital sepsis-associated AKI. And these are to be transferred to ICU for ICU therapy. So after knowing what is sepsis, then what is AKI? There are several guidelines to find out what is AKI. And it is RIFL or acute kidney injury or KDIGO. So for internist and nephrologist definition, and a nephrologist preference, KDIGO is the most common criteria being utilized in our daily clinical practice. And it says we will call a person who is having AKI if there is increment in the serum creatinine more than 0.3 milligram over the basal level, or more than 50%, that is within more than 3 milligram per, more than 0.3 milligram creatinine level over the basal level within 48 hours. And if there is 50%, more than 50% increment over the basal level over 7 days. And so far, urine criteria is concerned, if the urine output less than 0.5 milliliter per minute for more than 6 hours. But this is very difficult. But still, on this, this is not foolproof guideline for acute kidney injury. But on this criteria, we divide acute kidney injury into 3 stages. After the criteria is met, as I have discussed in the previous slide. So then we divide it. If it is AKI, diagnostic criteria wise, we divide it into 3 stages: stage 1, stage 2, and stage 3. Stage 1, if serum creatinine is 1.5 to 1.9, just short of 2 times of the basal level, or urine output 0.5 milliliter per kg per hour for 6 to 12 hours. And stage 2, if the creatinine level 2 to 2.9 times above the basal level, that's just short of 3 times, but above 2 times, and urine output is 0.5 milliliter, less than 0.5 milliliter per kg per hour, more than 12 hours. In first stage, it was 6 to 12 hours. And stage 3, if the serum creatinine is more than 3 times, equal to or more than 3 times, and urine output, not 0.5 milliliter, but it is 0.3 milliliter per kg per hour, more than 24 hours. Or patient is having anuria for more than 12 hours, or patient has to be put on due to adiabatic features on RRT. So these are all stage 3. So does KDIGO, as I have expressed, that is it a foolproof? No, it has got its own limitation. All the criteria, whether RIFL or ACHI or KDIGO, all these are very closely related, little bit difference from one to each other, but everything has got its own drawback. So what is the drawback if I go by KDIGO? So there is, till today, there is no consensus method exists to establish pre-AKI baseline serum creatinine. If not, before the onset of the disease process or infection, patient got one laboratory report. So it's very difficult to get the base level. So whether it is 2 times or 1.5 times or 3 times, it's very difficult. Sometimes changes in the serum creatinine are often delayed. Why? If it is delayed, then you won't be able to find out whether patient is having AKI or not with sepsis or infection, going to, because this is delayed, going to renal reserve and the kinetics of the AKR. If there is some residual renal reserve, though, it will definitely be delayed. And urine output. Urine output measurement is also insensitive in our general world, you all know. And it is often measured accurately only in ICU. So these are the 3 important drawbacks to find out in its early stage whether patient is developing AKI or not. So we have to have some other criteria to get to diagnose the development of AKI in its early stage to save patient's life, to save patient's cost. So out of all the in-hospital patients, all in-hospital patients with or without renal involvement, we can divide all group of in-hospital patient population into 4 groups. When the patient is not having no functional loss or any damage to the kidney, that is patient is hospitalized but no kidney function is altered, number 1, on the left panel. The second is pre-renal azotemia. For pre-renal azotemia, we all know there is loss of function. But in early years, early hours of pre-renal azotemia, there is no kidney damage. But due to loss of functions, due to glomerular filtration rate is reduced to a great extent, so urea creatinine is increased. So urea creatinine increased, but there is no damage. So definitely we have to bank upon some other criteria. And you know that 40 to 80% of all AKI is due to pre-renal azotemia. So almost 50% of in different studies it shows it ranges from 40 to 80%. So at least 50% of AKI is due to pre-renal azotemia. But renal creatinine is increased, but there is no damage. Because if we can treat this pre-renal azotemia very rapidly with hemodynamic corrections and the glomerular filtration rate comes to normal, it will definitely revert back to normal state and without any renal damage. But there is another category of patients in hospital patients that is subclinical AKI. What happens here? Here, there is damage in the kidney, but due to some reserve function of the kidney, you won't be able to see any raised urea creatinine. So kidney is damaged, but urea creatinine is not raised. In pre-renal azotemia, there is no kidney damage due to loss of function, urea creatinine is raised. And there is intrinsic AKI where damage is there, loss of function is there, urea creatinine is raised. So from this discussion, we can jolly well understand that urea creatinine is not a very sensitive biomarkers for detection of renal failure in early stage. So we have to incorporate some other biomarkers for getting or diagnosing acute kidney injury in its early stage. So here lies the importance of the biomarker in our practical daily life, in our bedside treatment of infections or sepsis. So early recognitions of AKI in the setting of infection. So if there is increase in biomarkers in the setting of infection, you don't know whether it has converted into sepsis or not. If you see the biomarkers are raised, I will come to the number, name the biomarkers in my next slide. So you will consider that infection is gradually getting converted to sepsis. And if already you have diagnosed in the setting of sepsis, the vital to provide optimal treatment or avoid further kidney injury, that it will say that there is a severe sepsis. So the use of injury or stress markers together with measures of functions may provide more information than either alone. So what are the biomarkers? So there are several biomarkers, and most physicians alter therapy depending on changes of serum creatinine, which is still being done as of today, but not very sensitive. So various AKI biomarkers, they are coming to the last line that they are specifically AKI-specific biomarkers are cystatin C, NGOL, that is neutrophil gelatinase-associated lipokalin, KIM-1, that is kidney injury molecule 1, IL-18, LAFA-BP, and angiopoietin 1 and 2, and TIM, that is tissue injury metalloproteinase 2, and IGFB7. There are various other biomarkers, all are discovered and validated. So I will describe a few of them. So cystatin C, how it is being helpful more than creatinine, because cystatin C is being raised in a state when there is creatinine blind range of GFR. Within 40 to 70, depending upon the various patients, then within 40 to 70, there is no rise of creatinine, but cystatin C will show its rise in the blood. And it is more important, it is independent of gender, muscle mass of the patient, and age of the patient. Creatinine definitely depends on all these factors. So that is the benefit of cystatin C. Then NGOL, neutrophil gelatinase associated lipokalin, these are released by the activated neutrophils as well as by the tubular epithelial cells. And they are being found both in blood in raised amount as well as in urine. And plasma and urinary NGOL levels are increased more so in sepsis-associated AKI than any other causes of AKI. So we can go for estimations of NGOL in both in serum as well as in kidney. So urinary kidney protein molecule, urinary kidney injury molecule type 1, KIM-1, what is that? It is also upregulated in the tubular epithelial cells in the tubular epithelial after ischemic and nephrotoxic injuries. And they are being excreted in the urine. So urinary KEM could be a very good predictor of AKI. Sensitivity is to the tune of 70%, and specificity is further higher, that is 86%. So this can be also good help in the early diagnosis of AKI. Now, the last one I want to describe is angiopoietin 1 and 2. Angiopoietin 1 is preventive for AKI development, and 2 is in favor of AKI development. So the ratio of 1 and 2, if there is more than 1, then it is protective. If the ratio is reversed, the angiopoietin is less, but the 2 is more, then you have to think that patient is going to develop AKI. So these are the important few biomarkers that we can utilize in our daily practice for early detection, because they all are being excreted either in the urine, depending upon which one we are going for detection, or in the blood within 2 to 4 hours of development of AKI. So pathophysiology for development of AKI, there are various hypothetical things we have to consider, but that is the hypoperfusion, ischemia, hypoxia, as well as oxidant stress, bacterial toxin-induced cytokine, epithelial injury, reactive oxygen species, reactive nitrogenous species. All these can produce inflammations as well as injury to the kidney structure or kidney tissue. So this slide apparently appears to be a little bit busy, but I will take you through in a very simple way, because it's a very important, and this cartoon was given in Kidney International Journal in 2019. Whenever patient is admitted to us, it is admitted with sepsis when patient has already developed from the day one AKI, or patient has admitted with sepsis. Now, after a few days in hospital stay, then patient develops AKI. So whatever may be the development of serum AKI, they may have four or five fail. One, AKI due to very efficient early treatment may go early reversal and then followed by complete recovery. And others may show partial recovery, no recovery, and ultimately development to acute kidney disease. What is the difference between acute kidney disease and acute kidney injury? If the acute kidney injury persists for more than 7 days, it is called acute kidney disease. So all these fate of sepsis-associated AKI, ultimately all these fate may go complete recovery, either late or early. But after, here lies the problem, after complete recovery, you shouldn't give a sigh of relief, because these are the patients, if they are again develop some infections or they are being prescribed some other reason for some other diseases, any nephrotoxic drugs, or they have developed some cardiovascular disease which has led to development of some hemodynamic instability, they again develop AKI when you are thinking that patient is already has overcome from AKI. They have really overcome from AKI during your discharge, but that insult and maybe relapse AKI can occur for months to occur. So we have to, for up to 90 days, so 3 months. So you have to be very careful. So whenever patient has recovered from AKI, not to put any nephrotoxic drugs for any reason, and patient should be educated to avoid getting any infections or any cardiovascular events. So these are the important things you have to advise patients on discharge. Now I am just showing you a meta-analysis, what it says. Now, out of 1341 patients with septic shock, almost 600 patients with developed stage two and stage three AKI. What was the fate of these 600 patients? Out of that, I divided it for easy remember, 20%, 30%, and 50%. 20% died within 7 days due to AKI and sepsis, 20% died. So rest 80%, 30% developed AKD, that is AKI persisted for more than 7 days. And the rest 50% went for early reversal. And whenever they are going for early reversal, If what I have discussed, if you be very cautious about that, the sustained reversal persists in 85% cases, but few percentage of them, almost 5 and 9% of them, again develop relapse AKI due to some infections and sepsis or some nephrotoxic agents. But those who have 30% have developed AKD, 90% of them, once they have regular, only 10% go for late reversal to normal function, kidney function, but 90% never reverse. So AKD is common after septic shock. Almost 30% can develop AKD. And existing AKI biomarkers, that is to be kept in mind, have limited utility for predicting AKD. These biomarkers are very much useful and could be found within 2 to 6 hours of development of AKI, but these are not helpful in predicting which patient will develop AKD and might be useful together with clinical variables. So how to treat all these patients? There should be a parallel and sequential approach whenever you are coming across a patient of sepsis with associated AKI. What is the parallel approach? Because you all know, being internist or being related to any medicine allied department, you know, all know that whenever you are dealing with sepsis, you have to go for rapid infection diagnosis, early antimicrobial therapy that must be nephro-friendly, renal-friendly, and source control and prevent secondary nosocomial. But side by side, parallelly, equally important is initial fluid bolus and adequate fluid therapy to recover from pre-renal followed by development of AKI, pre-renal azotemia. Consider ICU admissions, then minimize unnecessary nephrotoxic drugs when patient has got early reversal or during AKI. You shouldn't use any nephrotoxic drugs, and a hemodynamic guided approach of fluid therapy is to be maintained in all 4 patients. If patient is improving satisfactorily, it's okay. But if not, then you have to think about the renal replacement therapy. And during follow-up, if you are going to discharge patient, this should be told
the marker for
to the
lucid.
Yes, with our one more slide. Discharge, it is to be told to patient that they should not be falsely elated that their creatinine is normal, because discharge creatinine is unreliable. So you have to go for long-term CKD risk management and detections and preventions of AKI. So just a minute. And the last two, I am not being able because my battery is running low. So the take-home message is that 50% of sepsis is associated with AKI, and biomarkers are very much useful so far diagnosis of AKI is concerned. And so for the biomarkers, that is end goal, and it is not being practiced by us, but we have to be aware to practice it, and we have to press our government as well as the laboratories to go for these factors, as well as one important thing that is to be kept in mind, that if we can detect AKI early, we can prevent mortality as well as morbidity to a great extent in this sepsis-associated AKI group of patients.
Thank you, Dr. Karmakar.
Thank you for the